Hello, and welcome to SoberCast, where we provide AA speaker meetings and workshops in podcast format. We're an ad-free podcast, and if you enjoy listening, please help us be self-supporting by visiting SoberCast.com, look for the donate link, and drop a dollar or two into our virtual basket. We hope you enjoy the podcast. Have a great day.
February 27, 1996. I'm talking with James. I hope I said that correctly, James.
Hi.
It's so good to meet you again over the telephone lines, all the way from Maryland. And I have a trouble pronouncing the name of the town that you live in.
It's
Timonium.
That's perfect.
Timonium, Maryland. James is 90 years old and is probably the only person alive today who worked with Bill Wilson when he was in the Oxford group in New York back in the mid-1930s. And, James, I'd like to start by asking you to give me a little bit of background information on where you were born and where you grew up in education and how you made contact with the Oxford group or how they made contact with you.
Well, I don't know if I can give you this in a nutshell, Wally, but I was born in a little town in Maryland by the name of Walkersville.
Okay.
February 21st, 1906. And I, shortly after I was born, I moved into a farm in Searsville, which is just a short distance away. I lived on the farm until I was 12 years old, and I moved to Frederick. And spent most of my young teenage life there. I was 12 years old when I moved there. And had very little spiritual contact. So we lived on a farm and we used to go to church every Sunday. I don't remember ever going to church.
But oh, okay.
From there, I had never been baptized. Before I could join church, they had the same day for the church. But going back to my, I had my first drink when I was 5 years old. I used to get into my mother's Dandelion wine, and then I'd fill the bottles with water so she could know it. And I had this addiction, I guess, of the only child who took a pint of Dandelion wine at school. It was the first day of school. I thought that was par for the course. I've been drinking a whole lot, so I just kept on.
Oh, talk about an early drinker.
He's in school.
You're talking about the first grade?
Yeah, first grade, I took a bottle of wine with me the first grade. I continued all through my teenage thing to drink the wine. Then in 1918, while the fellows were away at war, the women got together and formed the Prohibition Movement and ordered the liquor out of the country, and we didn't have any more than so on in 1933. But during that time, we had to make the homebrew and depend on what they called Bantrapien and homebrew. Rock got liquor that was brewed in some fashion. And there's no bar rooms, of course, in those days. We had to meet in people's homes. And this was what we did on weekends.
Okay.
I went to high school, there's places that, and I got married in 1930. And that was a sort of rocky marriage because I didn't want to be tied down. I was a free agent, like you roam the range.
Okay. What were you doing for work at the time?
Well, I got a job with the power company when, 1930 I got it. In the meantime, I've been to Florida and just, shopping around with different power going to all my life, and I got involved in the basketball game down there. We barnstormed out in the Midwest for 2 years in the wintertime, and I did that. And I
well, you out. Sure were a free spirit, weren't you?
And when I come back, then I would I get a job wherever I could, and fill in until it's time to go. So again. And then I met a girl at a good college, Trent Merlin, and she fell in love, and after we were married, we were married a month, I guess, and I told her that I'm sorry I ever saw her, because I didn't want to be tied down. And the family said, the family told me they'd investigate me, and they told her I wasn't any good. And she was very proud, so she went back to her home and said, you were right, this guy wasn't any good, so she decided to stick it out. And so we went forward on a armed truce marriage.
Armed truce.
Which was going nowhere but downhill. Until I met the Oxford group, and meeting Oxford group is a long story. There was a fellow who owned up, he was president of a hosiery mill there in Frederick, and he had met the Oxford group, and he thought that that was a good thing to me, so he kept insisting, engineering every way to get me into the Oxford group, and so finally, one night we did meet the Oxford group, and that was in Frederick. And
you said to meet the Oxford group. Are you talking about just meet some Oxford group members, or you actually went?
Yeah, what happened was that he invited a team of Oxford group fellows to come from Washington up to Frederick, and he had some of his mill people and the fellows of the mill. Come, and we met in a room that, when I was 12 years old, that was, this is 34, so that had to be, 16 years, before that. I had made a decision, to give my life to God in an evangelistic meeting. In that same YMCA, but it didn't take. I saw so-called Christians around me, and they weren't living any different than I was, so I thought that was just part of the course. So I thought I was in the ball game. But then I got involved in the church and I was teaching Sunday school when I left the Oxford group. What I talked about on Sunday morning had no relationship to what I did on Saturday night. And I found that alcohol was not my problem at all. My problem was dishonesty.
Okay.
And I worked for a power company at that time, and I got paid a salary. But I worked overtime, and I didn't get paid overtime. So I felt perfectly justified in batting my professor down. I even had a jumper on my electric meter.
You know how to do that, of course.
I was in the meter department, and I knew how to do it. I paid 1 week's current out of the month. And so the thing that hit me between the eyes was absolute honesty. That led into a whole bag of worms that have to be straightened out. And then the book went in the Oxford group, and Bill Wilson touched on it some in the 12 steps, but he didn't emphasize it as much as the book. This is restitution. And I think that's it. Restitution opens up the whole thing.
It frees the soul. So the
problem of restitution was something that cleans your own slate, that you've got a good feeling inside, and all cleaned up and ready to go. And sure, it's that do. When I was 12 years old at Frederick, it was back in 1918. I worked for a fellow who had an electric store, and I worked for nickel an hour. I worked 10 hours a day, so I got 50 cents a day. I worked 6 days a week, I got $3 a week. And I became fascinated with the electric bulbs, wires, and extensions, and all that. I wanted to put these in my home. So I couldn't buy them, so I sold them from it. So now 18 years later, I go back to, I had to go back to him to make an investigation. So happened at that time, he and I were both elders on the same church board.
Oh my.
It's made it a little sticky on the deal. But, I wanted to give him this money. He said, well, I'll have to give to the church. I don't want to. I said, well, it's your problem. My problem is to pay you back, this money. And then he said the same thing. He said, you have time for coffee? And I said, yeah. So we went across the street and he said, look, I never had anyone to get out of just the way before. And he said, I feel happy to be honest with you. He said, my wife and I are on the verge of divorce. So I haven't been through to it. And the papers are gone. I don't see any way out. But you gave me an idea. I'm going to back and be absolutely honest with her about my life. She might be able to straighten this out. Which they did. That galvanized my mind the necessity and importance of investigation.
Not just for yourself, but for the other person also.
That's right. You see, everyone has an experience, has had an experience of restitution, and not realizing what it was or the importance of it. But every one of us has had an opportunity at some time in our life, we've been at loggerheads with someone, and we've said that something to that person that we're sorry for. We've often gone back and said, look, I'm sorry, I didn't mean what I said at that time. Invariably, the other person will say, well, look, it wasn't all your fault. I had a part in it, too. So that's just forget about the thing. But what has happened there, what has been a barrier between the vertical barrier between those two people now becomes a horizontal bridge, which new relationship is going to have. You get across that bridge into the other person's life as you've never done before. And that is the simplest form of restitution I can think of. It happens, but you can understand what I'm talking about here, of how restitution builds a new relationship with people, you see?
Oh, that's it.
And it's the ideal way to open a witness, too.
Yes.
Is you go back to someone that there's loggerheads with them. You belong in some way and make restitution for that. That opens up a whole new, let's say, reception room in that other person's life, where they receive things from you and other people that would be have never taken before. So this is reasonable when you insist upon restitution. That's very important. That's very important aspect of the deal.
You talked about Bookman. Of course, I'm sure you had a chance to get to know him over the years.
Oh, I knew Frank very well, yes.
Can you just describe how he acted, how he conducted his business when he was just with you, just... did he emphasize anything in particular in terms of what he was passing on, or did he even mention at all where any of this guidance that he had received was coming from in terms of maybe background in religion or anything along those lines? Did you ever know where Frank, I'm well aware of his spiritual experience at Kenswick, England, I think about 1909.
It was in Kenswick, yeah.
Yes, yeah. With a lady preacher, and he saw the vision of the cross.
That's right.
Did he ever talk about anything else he used, or where he picked up any of the other material, especially like the guidance and the quiet time or any of that?
He He threw a lot from some of the early evangelists, particularly Henry Drummond. He threw a lot from Henry. And there's a danger in saying when we interpret God to our understanding. So I've had certain sponsors refer to God. They said, "Well, the God of your understanding. You can think of God as a light bulb or a doorknob." They say, "Well, now a doorknob or a light bulb has no power to change people's lives."
No.
Then you lose the power of God in your life. So, on the meeting,
can you run through an Oxford group meeting, how it would open and any type of format?
These are the things that are meaningful in people's lives. And
absolutely
then they get beyond just a personal personal release. And I believe that's one of the reasons why people are sticking to just trying to keep themselves sober, because the vision that we are, or the level that we've reached in our vision is such that it's almost just a personal problem now, and it does become related to how you can change the world. See, Bookman's idea was always to change people with results.
You change the world.
He said you could vote the Democrats in, vote the Republicans out, or vice versa, but unless you deal with the basic motives of those people involved, you'll always end up with the same thing. And that's true.
You got to get to the cause and condition.
That's right.
Well, that is an uncanny observation about the AA meetings. I make it a point to state from the podium that I'm not going to do a drunkalog just because of that. I hear far too much of it. And I'll do my my story in less than 2 minutes. And then the rest of the hour is all on the conversion experience and my life afterwards.
That's the way it should be. I'm not hearing that in
my I'm not either. No.
It might be different than others. Mine just...
No, there's just a few of us doing this, and we're doing it because this is the way we've heard it from the old timers in AA.
That's right. You see, on the 12-step program, you analyze this alcoholic only mentioned once. You know?
Yes, that's right. The only
that's
one.
That's the first step.
And
he
after that?
He's mentioned alcoholics in the last step, but well, that's alcoholic. But alcoholics are only mentioned in the first step. And when they designed the culture, they meant it to deal with the whole person.
Yes.
But because you're emphasizing alcohol, it's sort of gravitated to that level. And I think we have more to offer people than just because we need to attract people in other areas. The thing I'm running to in here is that you have an alcoholic wife or an alcoholic husband, see? They aren't interested, the husband or the wife, not the alcoholic, is not interested in going along, unless they are dragged in to an alcoholic meeting or something. But in general, they're not interested because they think that's not their problem, so they don't. But yet, there may be an unsolved relationship existing between the two of them that remains untouched. And that is the overall philosophy of the Oxford Group. It was into the bedrock that everyone's life with the four standards. That touches every area, and you've got to be very, very callous person if you aren't touched in some way by that philosophy.
In terms of the Oxford Group meetings, who does anybody that you remember that was particularly inspirational in being able to carry that message? I know some people could speak better than others, but who were the most inspirational people in your life, especially those early days in the 30s? Anybody that sticks out as being particularly?
Perhaps you might, of course.
He really could do it. I've only read his material, and he spoke once at an AA meeting in 1960, and that's on tape. And once in 1963 or 4 on the history of AA. Those are the only two times I've ever heard him on tape. So
yeah.
he really had the magic. Huh? He really could.
Oh yeah, there was no question about that. And then of course, Bookman himself was a very direct figure, but he was not a personable fellow. In other words, he was not an attractive fellow. He wasn't a physically attractive fellow. But yet he had a spiritual spark of dynamic about him that did something to you. I guess one of the greatest life changes I ever met in my life was a fellow named Lee Hicks. who was son of a Episcopalian minister, and he had a way about him of going directly into people's lives. I would in the early day we had elevators, always running elevators, and I'd be in a conference and he'd sit on an elevator, and before we got to the floor, this fellow Cleepix was talking to this elevator boy about the deepest things in his life.
Oh.
And not in a sanctimonious hallelujah, praise the Lord type of way at all, but just in a very passionate way. He had something that would go right into that person's life and ask the right questions, you know. And he was only 45 when he died. Those fellows, many of those guys died early, including Peter Harris, so they just burned themselves out in their vigor and their endeavor to carry this message into the lives of all the people that they met. And in the early day, Bookman had a team of about, it varied, but it was usually around 150 young, unmarried, mostly men, people, who could move to a trouble spot overnight. They moved, but now that's no longer possible in the Yorkshire in small realm movement. The people, resident people, their families, they're not mobile like they were. But Bookman had the ability to move this thing to any part of the world overnight if he wanted to, and he did this all.
Oh, yes. Well, that's how it came to Akron, Ohio.
Yeah.
As a request of Firestone.
When it came to the Firestone test, see? And then out of that, Mrs. Ford said, Frank, you must take this, idea of this work to Mackinac Island. So we went up and we hired the Island House for a dollar. It was owned by the state, and they got it for a dollar a year. They renovated it, and we had summer conferences there for many, many years, 1945 into, I guess, 60s, early 60s. That came out of an Akron meeting, so it was just a progressive type of thing.
The Mackinac Island links directly to Akron.
Oh, sure.
Oh, okay.
So that's the first time I heard that. This is Edison there. And now, of course, G. Henry Williams was a very active person on the Mackinac Island thing.
Ah, I did not know that either.
Oh, sure. And all of that crap used to come in to Mackinac.
What about Henry?
About 1942 or 1943, I think it was when it started.
Okay, what about Henrietta Seiberling? Did you ever meet her?
Henrietta?
Yeah.
Yeah, Henrietta, of course, she was a drinking, drinking girl of the Seiberling family, one of the joints in their size. She had an apartment. When she got changed, her apartment became one of the centers for the Oxford group. And
that's what I'm beginning to realize, that she really was a spark plug.
Yeah, well, she claimed that the AA movement started in her apartment when Dr. Bob and Bill got together there and had guidance plan to start the AA movement. G. Henry Williams always said, he'd point to a place in his living room floor, he said, the AA movement started right there when Bill Wilson got down and gave his life to God. He said, that's where it started.
And
wow. It's always a good, but regardless, it started in Akron, and it, whether it started with the planning session or whether it was started
at the first meeting,
it started with a commitment to Bill's life.
And
Henrietta Savage was saying it started when Bill and Bob got together and planned the thing. But this was after both of them had made the decision in his life.
Yes.
But T. Henry's version of that, it may be the one with it started with the spiritual change in Bill's life.
And you think that took place right in T. Henry's living room?
T. Henry's home, yeah. T. Henry was, he designed the machinery for retreading tires. And, of course, this was a big thing, in the 30s there. And, so that put came in touch with Firestone and Cyberlink and Ford, Henry Ford, all the automobile and tire people. And that's how he got involved deeply into that segment of society.
That was the linkage which brought them all together.
Yeah.
The rubber business.
Yeah.
What about, oh boy, there's so many questions.
I could go off on
that's why we're gonna
these particular subjects. I could go on the tangent and tell you many stories, but we don't have time for all that.
Well, we're gonna make the time over the next several months and years, I hope.
Okay.
The T. Henry Williams and the, Henry Cyberling, stories, I believe that Henrietta, really was an integral part of the early, AA movement.
And, well, there's a question about that.
And, she definitely was not only there at the meeting, but was, actually quite, close to Ann Smith, Dr. Bob's wife, and, taught her, everything that pretty much Ann knew about the Oxford Group, she got from Henrietta. But I also learned that there was a falling out later in the 40s between Henrietta and Bill. Did you know anything about that? Okay.
After Bill left the Oxford Group, which is about, I think 1938.
Yes.
This occurred. Then, of course, I continued on with the Oxford Group, and in 1938, Lupton was in Germany, working with Hitler with this idea, trying to get him off his high horse, and he had a team there working with all of Hitler's men.
Yes.
And he was getting ready to go into Czechoslovakia, and the war clouds were forming, and people were talking about military armaments. And Lupton was in the Black Forest walking one day, and a thought came to him that the next great movement in the world would be the moral and spiritual rearming of men and nations. And so he began to talk in that context of armament. He began to talk that the real necessity in the world was the moral rearming of people, if you want to bring about a new world. And that's how then the name of the Oxford Group has changed because of circumstances. The movement, the first was the first Christian, first century Christian
fellowship. Yes,
that was the first one. Then in 1928, Bookman took some Oxford students down,
South Africa.
Down in South Africa.
Yes.
And you know, they
on the train,
the porter wrote the name Oxford Group on the doors because he got tired of interrupting people to where these people were.
I've read that.
So the name Oxford Group started. And then when 1938-39, Bookman began to talk about the moral rearming of nations, the word naturally gravitated to moral rearmament. Many people would say, well, it's out of date now, you should change the name. But, Wally, what are you changing the name? Regardless of what, unfortunately, things have to have names. Because as soon as you name something, it denotes membership. Then it denotes something, of course, then membership, you have to join something. This minimizes number two. It denotes a type of thinking. You galvanize the type of thinking in this. And this limits the number of people. So the minute you name something, you immediately minimize the number of people who are going to be followers of that idea. And it's unfortunate you have to name the friends. See, the idea... the Oxford Group has always been, and the AA movement should always be, that not to get people to join something, but an avenue by which you can get God in control of their lives. That's the thing.
That's exactly what it's all about. To get God in control and get us out of the way.
That's exactly right. Get yourself out of the picture and get God in control of your life.
So let me just, summarize the train incident in South Africa and
Frank going through the forest in
the Black Forest.
Both of those were true stories.
Oh, sure.
Okay, just wanted to make sure that that, sometimes we get a little bit of a myth, or sometimes it gets dressed up, or maybe even becomes bigger than life over the years.
No, no, that's all of that documents.
Okay, great. Let me take you back, if I could, to the meetings. One thing that, in talking with Jack here in Tucson a couple years ago, a gentleman that you say that you've had a chance to get to know over the years, who retired here, he mentioned that the Oxford Group meetings were all non-smoking meetings. There was never any smoking or refreshments during the actual meeting.
Oh, no, smoking was one of the visible signs that there was something wrong in it, you see. So smoking was, I don't know of any people in the Oxford Group who were in the group that smoked, you see.
Because if your life had changed, it...
That's right, that's exactly right. and that's what people can't understand is why, you see, here people fight alcohol, but in our church we have to have one whole wig there repainted because of smoking. The AA people smoking, they were using the church, you know, and they seemed to substitute coffee drinking for alcohol.
Well, let me again mention at least there's hope.
There was
James.
No coffee in the Oxford Group meetings. There was no refreshment at all. It was all spiritual food that they were.
All doing. Spiritual food.
Yeah, and when Bill Wilson come to our meetings, Frederick, he would first thing he always asked was, "Are you going to have any drunks here tonight?" And I said, "Well, I don't know if there was going to have if the people maybe some of these people were drinking. I don't know if it." He said, "Well, if you have anybody, I want to talk to him if you have any problem." He was just obsessed with giving what he found to every person that had an alcohol problem that he met.
Any drunks coming to the meeting, huh?
Oh, yeah. He was just, and he carried this idea with him all the time when he was Sam Shoemaker. And he got, and so he got to the point in the Gramercy church up there, and Sam's church. Bill got criticized because he wanted to hold meetings up there just for people with alcohol problems.
Yes.
And they said, "No, we don't." I said, "We don't want to take that approach. We want to our problems. I mean, our concept here is for changing the whole person." And
not just dealing with one small aspect of it.
Because, well, you can see when you deal with from a practical standpoint, you limit your, there are many people drinking and don't consider it a problem, see? And so therefore they aren't interested in alcohol. And it's also, one other thing that I found is that you're not dealing if when, often, if you don't deal with the other issues in a person's life, alcohol is usually the thing that takes them away from those problems. It's sort of a seclusion they go into, or a release from that particular problem. So if you deal with those problems, then you don't need the alcohol to take you away from them. See, and it's a reverse process in a sense.
Deal with the problem, and then you don't need to live with any false solutions.
Sure.
Which alcohol and drugs are all just false solutions. The other thing that Jack mentioned, and you touched about it earlier when we first got together on the phone, was about how people dressed when they went to the Oxford Group meetings. That people wanted to demonstrate that yes, their lives had changed, and that this was a special event in their lives to go to an Oxford Group meeting, and they and you said that I believe that everybody wore a coat and tie, and the women did dress.
I mean, did he say it was evidence of their change?
He said it was just one way that they demonstrated that their lives had changed.
Well, that's interesting. I never, I can agree with that, but I mean, I never.
Oh, okay.
But I was always conscious. No, no, Oscar Group, you put your best face forward.
Best face forward.
Yeah, yeah. And there was no refreshments or there was no coffee or anything like that. Then, while after these people spoke, then the meeting would just begin. See, that was just preliminary. The meeting,
okay.
The meeting would begin when they would you would start talking with people around the room, and you'd soon see people pair off and they'd go and talk about these would be people talking in deeper sense about their own life, and then these people were taken through. You take them through a series of steps in order to get them changed. In other words, we had what's called the 5 C's. You're familiar with those?
Yes, I am.
And then we were taught how to do a life-changing process. And so then, when you say
you were taught, were you taught just by the experience of attending the meetings, or was there formalized?
We'd have a classroom. Session on the 5 C's.
And how
these 5 C's would relate to how we could bring our experience, translate our experience into another person's life, where it results in their change too. You see, that's what I'm talking about, is how you multiply another person's life. I mean, your change into the life of another person. Now, people innocently in churches who never get beyond the experience maybe can't be condemned for them because they don't know how to do this. You see,
in AA, they don't know how to do it either.
We were taught this in the Oxford Group, how to bring this about.
Now, these classroom sessions, were they part of the meeting or after the meeting or separate from the meeting?
These weren't all that prevalent, but every now and then in a team meeting where you'd have strictly a team meeting.
Okay.
Where you wouldn't necessarily have any, you would talk about these elements of life changing, where people would have a chance to tell of their experience with bringing a person to Christ and how difficulties they might be having. And it was a matter of how you could hone your team's experience to the point where you would make the maximum effort. You see, the Oxford Group was basically an evangelistic movement.
Oh, yes.
Without all of the ecclesiastical trimmings and everything, it was in a very practical sense. Very similar to the How Do I Begin pamphlet. See how direct that is.
Oh, very
how simple that is.
Yep.
And that's the way the Oxford Group was leading people to Christ in a very sane, practical way.
Without all the dogma and the ritual.
That's right. That drives people away. Often.
Oh, what about the other thing that Jack mentioned was the moment of silence. The moment of silence. The meetings that he remembered back in the 30s were that they actually opened with silence, and that the moment of silence would sometimes be as long as 5 minutes, so that people could get in touch with God or in tune with God.
Yeah, I would. I can't remember that as being the format of every meeting, but yes, I can remember some meetings were like that. But that sort of varied with the leadership and the locale and that sort of thing.
Do you think maybe the moment of silence was more prevalent in the Midwest than on the East Coast?
Could be. Because the moment of silence wasn't all that prevalent in my experience.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, because I know that Jack attended quite a few meetings in the Akron and Cleveland areas,
as well as back on the East Coast, and he may have been drawing upon that experience too. What about the meetings that Bill Wilson attended? You said that you had a chance to meet Bill.
The way this happened was that we in Frederick, we had a team at that time of around 35 or 40 people, I guess. It would vary, and people move in, move out. But usually we would have that many in the meeting, and we began to have meetings at the old Francis Scott Key Hotel, Frederick.
Okay.
And I had a room down in the basement called the Blue and Gray Room, and that was a very popular meeting room. And we used to have these meetings on Saturday night at that time. Bill Wilson was a stockbroker in New York, and after, I guess, a week on Wall Street, and he was pretty well tired out. He had a habit of coming down to visit friends around Leesburg, Virginia. And this was horse country. You had these big country estates. And Bill would come down there for the weekend just to relax and be with friends. And he heard about these meetings over in Frederick, and this is about a 15-mile trip.
Okay.
And he would come over on Saturday nights to, and he'd come in, he introduce himself. And, I remember when that started. And, but regardless of when he came, he would always ask the same question, are we going to have any drunks tonight? And then Bill spoke on several occasions, I remember. And this went on for, I guess, a couple of years. And then I didn't see Bill after that. He centered in New York with Sam Shoemaker and Sherry Day and all the fellows up there in New York. And I moved to Baltimore, and I didn't see Bill after that.
What did Bill strike you as in terms of being able to speak? Do you remember anything
about alcohol?
He always talked about alcohol.
Sure, he never talked about anything but alcohol.
Okay, I know, right?
When God touched his life on alcohol, it also touches on smoking, gambling, the wrong relationship with women, and Bill had a lot of those. He touched the whole person, you see. But Bill was so impressed how God had come into his life when he was desperate and took alcohol out of his life. He was so impressed with this that this was the biggest thing that he could think of in a way to witness to God's power in his life. So he talked mostly about alcohol.
Wow, that is interesting.
Yeah.
Because later on he did still have some difficulties in other areas. In fact, he actually died of emphysema.
Yeah.
He fought the cigarette problem off and on all his life.
Yeah.
Never really did wrestle that one to the ground. And of course he did have some women problems further on too. So,
You see, I think if
by concentrating on the alcohol, maybe he'd lost sight that his entire life had changed, not just in one area.
It's that when you de-emphasize the other issues when you emphasize just one issue in your life, see?
I'm listening. I'm hearing what you're saying.
You don't guard against those. The first thing you know, you slip overboard.
Yep. Because Bill also had a great deal of depression in his life, too, as a result of that. He always seemed to be doubting that he truly had been changed. And I think maybe that... he kept looking for another experience, like the one he had in Towns Hospital.
I think everyone tried that.
Right.
I tried that. I tried to go back and recapture my feelings at that original. You know, go back on retreats and try to rededicate your life again. It's never like that.
The first time, no. No, that's a once-in-a-lifetime experience.
That's
sure
right.
Is.
I remember when that night in the YMCA building that I was telling you about, five people got changed that night, that meeting. And they went out and they really upset the town, really, and what's happened from then on. But there was two guys, myself and another fella, were in the same church. And there was an old fellow who used to run the Tuesday night prayer meetings by the name of Brother Kesey, and he was a great fundamental Christian. We went to him and we talked, which he'd be delighted to know that two of these young people in the church had gotten converted. So we went in to him Sunday morning at that Sunday and said, Brother Kesey, we want to tell you that we gave our life to God last night. We were converted. And he said, did you see a shining light come down from heaven and sort of blinded you? And he said, no, we didn't see that. He said, I don't know, fellas. He said, I don't think you got it.
So
you could only get converted one way, the way he got converted. You see, and that was it. And so to him, you had to see that light, or you didn't. Or you didn't.
And I'm so glad that we don't all have to see the same light. Getting back to the meetings in Frederick, Maryland.
Yeah.
When you talked about Bill coming down from the weekend, he probably was traveling with a gentleman by the name of Fitz Mayo. Did you ever meet Fitz Mayo?
Yeah, I met Fitz Mayo. I don't remember Fitz Mayo. He may have come to one of those meetings in Frederick, but I don't remember. Yeah, I remember Fitz.
Because
yeah.
Fitz lived in that area, and Fitz got sober in 30. I think he was AA number 3. In fact, he was AA number 3 in New York. But he also had a place outside of Washington, D.C., and Bill would come down there for the weekends.
Yeah.
So that's probably the linkage of how Bill got to those meetings.
Fitz Mayo used to go to Washington City. He never, to my knowledge, he never came to Frederick.
Oh, okay. Well, okay, because he lived closer to Washington.
They had a large team in Washington. They had a team. They had a team of 100 or 150 people there in Washington. So we used to go down there quite often on weekends when they'd have a meeting.
That would make for quite a meeting, 100, 150 people.
Oh, yeah. Well, the first meeting I went to was here in Baltimore, that 500 in the Lord Baltimore Hotel. And after I came here, I got involved in the Oscar group. I still can't see how they got 500 people together, but they did.
Ever get a chance to go, like, to that meeting in the Berkshire Mountains? I think that was in 37, where there were 10,000 people. Or I heard tell the one in Los Angeles where they packed the Hollywood Bowl. And
oh, yeah, I was there. That was 30,000.
You were there at the Hollywood Bowl one?
Oh, sure. I was, when they introduced the Maui Arma, we had a Madison Square meeting that was 5,000, I remember. No, wait a minute, more than that, 10,000, I guess. The next one, we moved to Constitution Hall. That only seats 5,000. That was packed. And then we went from there right to California, where we had it in the Hollywood Bowl. People were turned away, and the capacity of the bowl was 30,000.
That's what I heard. I heard as many as 10,000 people were turned away.
There could be.
There was definitely an overflow crowd that they could only see.
You had all the, you know, all the celebrities there, you know, the movie celebrities. Remember the big night spotlights, the flashing, you know, and all that sort of thing. And we had they had four spotlights right back of the podium shooting straight up in the air. These were so powerful, all they had was a white beam, and they represented the four standards.
Oh, okay.
It was quite a dramatic meeting as far as the staging is concerned. They had all of the know-how of Hollywood available. You see, and they really
took advantage of it too.
Yeah.
Oh, I can imagine that was quite an event. Seen the pictures of the bowl filled and just read the reports. Then something to have actually been there.
I had the privilege of being to all three of those meetings.
Great. Constitution Hall.
Well, the first one was
Madison Square.
Madison Square Garden is the first one. And then the Constitution Hall and the Hollywood Bowl.
See, that all would have been 39, if I remember.
Right, 1939. The first meeting was 1938 in London, England, East London. That's where Wilder Hall was.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize that it actually had kicked off in England first.
Yeah.
That's after Frank had been through the Black Forest, then. I guess he decided to get right on it. And
well, it moves fast.
Of course, Frank wasn't successful in his contacts with Hitler, and I know that there turned out to be quite a flap about it, too, that there was...
Well, some of his... There was a great deal of headway made with some of his lieutenants.
I heard Himmler was listening.
Yes, there was some talk, but there was some younger lieutenants that was quite taken by the idea and everything. But, you know, Hitler was a dictator, and
oh, boy, yeah.
Whatever he said went, you know. So when he said throw that out the window, you see, well, it was thrown out the window. But yet, it was the basis, those seeds that were sown there were the basis of reconciliation between France and Germany when Madame Laura Switzerland apologized to the Germans for her behavior. And that brought that's a whole other story.
Yeah, after the war.
That is what both Hitler, both Schumann and Adenauer said that Madame Laura, more than any one person, contributed to the basic reconciliation between France and Germany more than any other one person. And that reconciliation is found in trees that still exist today. It will exist.
That was one of the where it did work, one area where it did work.
That's right. Many areas that it worked in.
But that's one that I've read about also, that is really one of the highlights. That's, even though we plant the seed, we never know where the tree's going to grow. And it grew a few years later.
That's right. And I think so. That's what I'm thinking. Some of the seeds with Hitler sowed in 1937-38 in Germany with Hitler's craft. Some of those people were the ones who came. There were 200 selected people that General Clay allowed to come, the first people that he allowed to come out of Germany, and they came to coast Switzerland for this conference. And these were 200 of what said are some of the top people, and well, they have to be some of Hitler's people. And,
who had been exposed previously.
Yeah, and of course then they were receptive to Madison's policy. And then went with them back to Germany and spoke hundreds of times, meetings, radio, wasn't TV then, but the message was always the same, you know, reconciliation and her change brought that happened in her life. This was the foundation for the past
retaliation. And so, fascinating piece of our history. We actually can see it working.
So while you can see what Bookman said, with the concept of the ultimate of Bookman's thinking of two men in nations, you see, and he was always thinking in terms of how people change could result in some national change or some change in the situation.
Yes, a one-liner that I remember, I'm not sure if this is accurate, I want to check this with you, is that one of the things he used to say was his objective was to change the world one life at a time. Does that ring true, or is that...
Well,
did he really use the one nation, one...
I never heard the expressed in
those words. Okay.
One life at a time, but
that may be an AA.
We talk about new man, new nation, new world. He's constantly saying that the new world has to start at you. You see.
Yeah.
And people are constantly talking about changing the world or creating something new in the world, but they're always thinking in terms of Timbuktu or
it begins with me.
Across the nation.
Yeah.
The world that most, what is the world to us? The world to us, I think, is the people we touch every day.
Yeah.
And if we can't affect something change there, how in the world are we going to change something over in Timbuktu?
Yes.
And we've got to deal with the basics in our own life as they relate to other people.
Let me make sure I get that right. It's new men, new nations, new world.
New world.
Got it.
That was your slogan. And we had lots of little slogans like you could, you can't keep the birds from flying over your head, but you can keep them from building nests in your hair. things like that. Used to say, it's not who's right, but what's right.
Yes. Well, didn't, one other part of the program. Let me touch on that before we run out of steam here. Is the guidance, the morning meditation, the quiet time.
Yeah.
Even in this pamphlet, this early pamphlet talks about actually with a pen and pencil writing down God's guidance and checking it out with somebody else who is also in contact with God.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate on that in terms of how important that was, or was it really emphasized that much?
Oh, sure, absolutely.
To me, it would be the heart of the program myself.
You see, a lot of people, were held up on some mysticism about why you write it down. Well, the reason for writing it down was very simple. Look, we used to say that the strongest memory is weaker than the palest thing. it's just a practical thing to so that your mind is clear for another thought, and your mind is not conscious of laboring remembering that thought. So you record it, and then it's a quick check at the end of the day to see if you followed the guidance. Just a practical thing, Wally. I mean, there's nothing mystic about it.
Oh, okay.
Or nothing biblical or this sort of thing. So if I would simplify his program, he brought to the Christian faith. The only thing he brought new to the Christian faith was the four standards.
Yep.
And again, emphasis on the guidance of God.
Yes.
So that was it. Which they were all there. They were all there. There's the Sermon on the Mount. That's where they came from.
Yep.
It was always there. I regret that they didn't take the fourth standard into the 12-step program. I know they say they're all there, which they are. The essence of them is there, just like when you read Sermon on the Mount. It's there. But they're not brought out to your attention as book because these four things out.
No.
Except
in areas of the country like in Akron and Cleveland, which still practice the four absolutes, and they are an integral part of the meetings, and they even have the four absolutes pamphlet that's still being published in Cleveland.
That's
but,
great.
I didn't know
they were published now, but that is great because, in 67, where it said, take a personal inventory. You know, well, how do you take a personal inventory? A personal inventory to everyone is different, you see? There are no guidelines by which you take the personal inventory. But the four standards are. And if you take, there isn't a question about that. If you take a personal inventory on the four standards, then everyone is doing it on the same basis.
Yes, that's also brought out in this little pamphlet, too.
Yeah.
And which I thought was very clearly stated. I'm really so grateful that you sent that pamphlet along.
I've never seen the program simplified so clearly. And I'm definitely going to make sure that reprints of that pamphlet get sent out all over the countryside.
That's great.
Because it's the first time I've seen it. And
look, it's not printed anymore. I may be.
You may be the one last.
I may be the only person that has one. I don't know. I haven't seen any of them around.
Well, that's why we need to make sure that we get them out, because we don't want to lose this piece of our history.
That's exactly right.
And that's an integral part of it that I'd like to make sure that we do. We carry forward so that it doesn't get lost in all the falderall that we seem to be seeing. And like you said, some of these AA meetings where all you do is hear drunk a log and all problem and no solution. And God is the solution, and that's what I truly believe that we're here to talk about when we go to meetings, is how God's changed our lives. And He's obviously changed your life, and I'm really looking forward to our getting together. If you would allow me to do so, I would love to call the Wilson House and let them know that you're coming. And
well,
make,
you know, but I'll take care of it. I'll get up one in the motel there. Don't crowd me in there, because that'll be inconvenient to someone else. And I'd rather just go into the motel, really.
Okay. I'd also like to invite you to share some of this on the podium. It's just for the record, because all of this is being taped, and I would like to have you speak for the record on the differences that you see between the AA meetings and the Oxford Group meetings and the emphasis and all of that. That is all vital information that people need to hear.
Yeah.
Or we're going to get so watered down and diluted that they'll think that we're just another, like Henrietta Seiberling said, Bill wanted to de-emphasize God.
Yeah.
This was back in, I believe in the late 30s, and they're in the process of writing the book of Alcoholics Anonymous, and he was talking to Henrietta about de-emphasizing the God part, and Henrietta said, we're not here to please the alcoholic, we're here to please God. The alcoholic's been pleasing himself all these years anyway.
Yeah.
But she said, if you take God out of the program, you might as well be the Rotary Club.
That's right.
And heaven help us if we ever become the Rotary Club, because as much of a value as they are, we definitely are supposed to be talking about a spiritual solution to the afflictions that have held us back from this conscious contact with God.
Well, in Rotary, we have the four steps, the four-way test, which is very, very similar to the four standards. And I've been teaching this program for 29 years now in schools. It's truth, fair to all concerned, will it build goodwill, better friendships, and will it be beneficial to all concerned? So you can see that the four standards are all intertwined in that. And some of the schools here usually are saying this along with the Pledge of Allegiance in the morning. Can't be attacked on a religious basis because it's a mild issue. And
I have heard it. I've heard that test stated differently. Can you do that again a little bit slower so I can?
Number one, is it the truth?
Is it the truth? Yes.
I'm sorry, they didn't say if it's the truth or not, because when you say is it the truth, you get into some sort of a connotation of little white lies, that sort of thing. I've even heard one of our AA sponsors here locally tell one of the people they were working with, it's okay to lie a little.
Oh my God!
Yeah, can you imagine that?
That's the blind leading the blind.
It's okay. This is one of the 12-step programs that I got involved in. But anyhow, is it the truth? The first.
Yep.
The second one, is it fair?
Yep.
All concerned. Number three, will it build goodwill and better friendships? Number four, is it beneficial to all concerned?
Wow.
That's the program.
Yep.
And
that's the test.
I've got one of those. This goes back to a morning quiet time that a fellow by the name of Herb Taylor had in the early 30s about how to to bankrupt this that he's been in charge, put in charge of. Those are no longer available. I have copies, and I'll send you one of those.
Now
these are related.
If you could, then I would certainly like to make copies of those for the conference, too.
Sure.
Because the four-way test, we have an old-timer from Cleveland that cut his teeth on the four absolutes and the five C's, and he talked about the four-way test, but in all of...
Rotarian?
I'm sorry?
Is he a Rotarian?
Now, that I'm not sure.
Yeah.
I'll ask him. His name is Cal Wallett, and he's been in AA since the early 60s, and his dad, he took his dad through treatment centers several times in the 50s, so he knew all the old-timers.
Yeah.
And he does, from the podium, talk about the four absolutes and the five C's, and he does talk about the four-way test. He does describe it a little differently. I'd love to, and I think maybe it's just over the years.
I've been dealing with it, I've been dealing with it, I've been in early since 47. And, because of my connection with the Oxford Group, I latched on to this four-way test as a medium, or a vehicle by which you can bring something new into the lives of people without getting too sanctimonious or something.
Oh, I like it very much.
And so I've been using this to a great extent.
And the one other thing I'd like to ask you is to repeat again the comment that Frank Bookman made about the writing down the guidance. I think you said the strongest memory.
He said the strongest memory. If this is a, he quotes this as a Chinese proverb.
Okay.
The old Chinese proverb, you used to go that. The strongest memory is weaker than the palest ink.
Than the palest ink. Okay.
Is weaker than the palest ink, which means that the palest, the palest ink is stronger than
any of our memory. Oh, that is beautiful.
See, the strongest memory is weaker than the palest ink.
That's a classic line. I'd like to use that if I could. Can I borrow that one?
It's Oxford Group material.
I will definitely, I want to carry that along because that is just clear and concise summary statement on the guidance that I've seen and why we write it down. This has been a great session. It's hard to believe, but we burned up an hour and a half here on the telephone lines, and I certainly want to do this again. James, I want to thank you kindly for sharing with us today on the early days of the Oxford Group and the connections and the similarities and differences as you see it between the Oxford Group, Moral Rearmament today, and AA, because AA has changed also over the years, and part of our mission as archivists is to get AA back to the basics, and the basics for the AA was the Oxford Group, and I think the closer we stay to our roots, the stronger the fellowship will become in the years ahead, but 95% of the people in AA don't even have a clue as to where we came from. And that's our mission, is to make that information available. And that's what's going to happen at the Wilson House, and that's why I would love to have you there.
Well, that's good. I'll certainly try to do it. In the meantime, I'll get any additional things that I think you might be interested in. That I have extra copies, so I'll send them on to you.
Oh, that four-way test. And what I'll do is I'll dig out that four absolute pamphlet that AA is still printing in Cleveland.
Yep.
And I'll zip that one your way.
That'd be great.
See that at least there's a pocket of enthusiasm left out here in the Cleveland area.
Yeah.
And I'll be in touch later, probably over the weekend or first next week. Do you have a message machine where I could leave a message if you're not there?
Oh, sure.
Okay. And keep you posted on what the feedback from the Wilson House is in terms of... I'm sure they're going to welcome you with open arms. Nell Wing, Bill Wilson's secretary, would love to meet you, as well as everybody that's going to be there. It's a small crowd, but these are people that are coming in all over the country, and these are the people that will be carrying that message back to the four corners of the United States as to what the early days meant, and you'd be such a welcome addition to this session.
I'm glad to be with
you. What a godsend that you're with us today so that we can still hear what it was
Chris
like.
For that, because she was one.
I am definitely going to be calling her tonight.
See, I talked to her we were, I forget where we were, we were to an Oxford group, MRA meeting here some time ago. Oh, I was talking to her about this, and she recalled it, and she called me on the phone the other day. So what we're talking about now came out of that conversation.
Oh, that's so, it's amazing how God works.
It is.
But he's working in all of our lives, and it shows.
I'm amazed every day.
Me too.
The truth that he brings into our lives.
Oh, well, you enjoy the day, and I'll be in touch with you real soon.
Thank you, Wally.
Thank you, James.
I look forward to it.
You take care.
All right.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thanks for listening. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. Sobercast is ad-free, and we'd like your help in order to keep it that way. So if you'd like to help us be self-supporting by pledging a dollar or two a month, visit Sobercast.com and look for the donate links. Thank you very much.